ठीक है, तो वी हैव अंडरस्टूड दैट देर इज समथिंग वियर्ड गोइंग ऑन व्हेन इट कम्स टू द एटम्स, फाइन. सो देर इज वन मोर वियर्ड थिंग अबाउट द इलेक्ट्रॉन रिवॉल्विंग अराउंड द न्यूक्लियस, ओके, दैट इज केम अप आफ्टर मैक्सवेल प्रपोज्ड हिज थ्योरी. अकॉर्डिंग टू मैक्सवेल, व्हेनेवर चार्ज एक्सेलरेट्स इट विल एमिट ईएम वेव. ओके, नाउ इलेक्ट्रॉन इफ इट इज मूविंग अराउंड द सर्कुलर पाथ इट इज एक्सेलरेटिंग, राइट, सो इट विल एमिट ईएम वेव, फाइन. सो दिस इलेक्ट्रॉन दैट इज मूविंग इन द न्यूक्लियस like this will emit EM wave. So if this emits EM wave, what will happen to its energy? Energy decreases, will go down. So energy should go down for the electron, right? And what is the formula for energy of an electron? Minus 1 by 2 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught E square by R, fine. Now if energy decreases, what happens to the radius? What will happen to radius? Decrease or increase? Decrease, right? Suppose this is right now minus 5. This is a negative quantity, no doubt. Suppose it is minus 5. If minus I have to decrease, what it should become? Minus 6 or minus 7. And if it has to become minus 6, the R should be less, so that this is more negative. Fine. So electron, if it is emitting EM wave, its radius should decrease and slowly it should spiral and come and hit the nucleus like this. Why Earth doesn't do like this? Because Earth has no charge, okay, it is happening because of gravity, fine. But according to Maxwell, if charge accelerates, it will emit EM wave. So if Maxwell has to be correct, according to that, the electron should revolve and spiral into the nucleus, but that is not happening, fine. So another weird observation, okay. So hence there was a requirement of a different kind of physics that could explain what is happening, because nobody is able to explain what is going on, fine. So Bohr came up with quantum physics to explain what is going on, fine. Bohr has proposed hydrogen atoms model, and he has given three postulates when it comes to hydrogen like atoms. So we'll first talk about three postulates or three principles on which the hydrogen atom works. Write down the first one. Electrons can revolve in certain stable orbits without emitting any radiation. So he started with this, that he was like, there are certain stable orbits, electron if it revolves around those stable orbit, it will not emit EM wave even if it is accelerating, fine. So the second postulate, write down. For these stable orbits, for these stable orbits, How do you identify these? The angular momentum should be quantized. Angular momentum of electron is quantized. What is the angular momentum of a mass moving in a circular orbit? MVR. MV, which is a linear momentum, cross with perpendicular distance. See, the thing is, this is the electron's path. Fine. This is the velocity. So its momentum is also along this line. So perpendicular distance of the momentum from the center is radius only. So MV into R is the angular momentum. Fine. So basically, MVR, when this is equal to NH by 2 pi, if an orbit satisfies this equation, if orbit satisfies this equation, then that is a stable orbit. Getting it? So electron can be in that stable orbit without emitting EM wave. But if it is not in the stable orbit, then what will happen? Then it will emit EM wave and it will reduce its radius and go to the next possible stable orbit. Fine. Third postulate. Electron can jump from one stable orbit to another stable orbit by emitting or absorbing a photon. The focus is a photon. It can't absorb more than a photon. More than a single photon, it can't. Okay? Only one photon it can absorb. So by absorbing or emitting a single photon, whose energy is difference in the energy of those stable orbits. You're getting it? So if energy of one stable orbit is E1, other is E2, E1 is more than E2, fine. Let's say energy of one orbit is E1 and other is E2 and E1 is more than E2. So if it is jumping from E1 to E2, it will emit or absorb photon? Emit. And if it is going from E2 to E1, absorb. How much energy? E2 minus E1. Or E1 minus E2, right? And that should be the energy of a single photon. It can't be that energy is coming from two different photons. Fine. So there is a fixed wavelength it can absorb, which is corresponding to the energy difference. And there is a fixed wavelength it can emit. That is why it emits or absorbs only fixed number of wavelengths. Getting it? Any doubt on these three postulates? No? Now, you'll see that whatever was the experimental observation, we'll be able to use these postulates to match, and you'll see that both are matching. For example, let us take postulate number 3. According to postulate number 3, energy of the photon should be equal to, let's say this is H times mu. This should be equal to what? E2 minus E1. Fine. So mu is what? c by lambda. This is E2 minus E1 for the electron, right? So 1 by lambda becomes what? 1 by lambda is 1 by h into c. Now E2 is what? E2 is minus half, this is total energy, minus half 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. Into E square by let us say it is R2 square, sorry R2 only, fine, minus of minus 1 by 2 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught E square by R1 square. Getting it? Fine. So R1 and R2 are what? Radius for energy level 2 and energy level 1. Fine. But then there are no integer coming up right now. Getting it? So just keep it like this. We will come back to this expression, okay, once we are able to derive R2 and R1 in terms of an integer. Okay, now tell me if this is the second postulate. Okay, if MVR is equal to NH by 2 pi, can you tell me what is the total energy? I don't want energy in terms of R, I want energy in terms of N. N. You have one more equation, so you can put the energy in terms of N. Derive it, please. That fourth equation is still valid. Mv square by R is equal to k q1 q2 by R square. That is valid, and this also is valid. So you have two equations to play with. Find out total energy. Able to? Are you able to, or should I do it? Okay. See, we have this equation mv square by r is equal to what? I'll just write k here. K times e square by r square. This we have, right? So one r will get cancelled. So I will get m into v square is equal to k times e square by r. Fine. Now kinetic energy is very easy to find. You can just multiply half to it, you get kinetic energy this, which you have already found out earlier itself. Fine. But then I want kinetic energy to be in terms of n, or total energy in terms of n. Fine. In order to do that, I'll square this equation. Let me square it. I get m square v square r square is equal to n square h square by 4 pi square. So I will get m v square is equal to n square h square divided by 4 pi square m into r square. This is what we will get. Okay. So you will get half of this is equal to that. Fine. But then still it is in terms of R only. You have this second equation.
This third equation.
Okay. If you equate them, okay, if you equate them, you'll get the value for R. This is equal to n square h square divided by 8 pi square m r square. So I'll just expand k also now. It is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. Fine. So 1 pi will get cancelled. 4 to the 8. 1 r will get cancelled. So r will come out to be n square h square by n square h square epsilon naught by pi m e square. Fine, this is r. Okay, now when you substitute that r there, you'll get the kinetic energy. So kinetic energy will be what? Equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, that is k, into e square divided by 2 times r, which is n square h square epsilon naught divided by 2 pi m e square. Okay, pi will go away, this is 2. So you will get m e to the power 4 divided by h square epsilon naught 2 times of that, epsilon naught square in fact. This into what? 1 by n square. Fine. So this is kinetic energy. Alright. What will be the total energy? Minus of this. Minus of this.
Let me just verify whether we have made correct calculation.
There is a factor of 8 coming in the denominator, which we have missed.
K by 2.
Kinetic energy is this only, right? K e square by 2 r.
Yeah.
There will be 2 coming in, so this is 8. This completely goes away, so this is gone. So, this will not be there, so this will be 4. Anyways, so we have made some silly error somewhere. This is actually 8, a factor of 8 will come here. Somewhere we have made a silly error, it should be 8 over here. Okay. So we have total energy is what? This is kinetic energy. So total energy should be negative of this. Fine. This kinetic energy. So total energy should be equal to minus of m e to the power 4 divided by 8 h square epsilon naught square into 1 by n square. Okay. So instead of E2 and E1, I can substitute that, fine. Rather than putting it in terms of radius, I can put in terms of n, where n is what? Principal quantum number, that is an integer, fine. So if you put it here, you get E2, which is minus of m e to the power 4 divided by 8 h square epsilon naught square into 1 by n2 square, take that common, it will be 1 by n1 square. Fine. So if you put minus inside, okay, if you take minus inside, this thing will become n1 and this will become n2. Fine. And then this whole thing, this, this, and this will become Rydberg constant. When you put the values, you get the same thing. 1 by lambda is Rydberg constant, 1 by n1 square minus 1 by n2 square, okay, where n1 is less than n2. Fine. Always remember, it is this n1 which determines what series it is, the lower number. If the electron jumps from 3 to 2, which series it is? Bomber. If it goes from 2 to 4, what it is? Bomber only. The lower number determines what series it is. So now we have a model based on which we can understand what is going on in hydrogen or hydrogen-like atom. For hydrogen-like atom, the same formula becomes like this. 1 by lambda is equal to Rydberg constant into Z square. 1 by N1 square minus 1 by N2 square. This is for hydrogen-like atom, having atomic number more than 1. Getting it? And you can arrive here easily. When you write this equation, mv square by r, if it is higher atomic number, what you'll write here? 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, q1 is now z times e. And this is e divided by r square. Okay? And mvr is still equal to nh by 2 pi. So if you start like this, you will get it here. So you'll be able to find out radius. In fact, we have found radius first in terms of n. It is proportional to n square. Energy is proportional to 1 minus 1 by n square. You're getting it? Similarly, you can get velocity. Alright? So now let us try to find out the energy corresponding to nth level. We have derived an equation, right? How much that was equal to? Minus of energy in the nth orbit. How much this was? Minus m e to the power 4 divided by
8
h square
epsilon square into 1 by n square
into n square. Okay? So when you substitute all the values, you get energy in the nth orbit to be 13.6 divided by n square electron volt. In terms of joule, how much this will be?
Into
charge of electron. Fine. So energy in the nth orbit is this. And if you take that third postulate, Bohr's third postulate, simply you have to do this. You know, minus 13.6 n1 square minus of minus 13.6 n2 square. This is delta E, change in energy. That should be equal to hc by lambda. Of course, this should be multiplied with charge of electron E. Getting it? E2 minus E1, sorry. E2 minus E1 should come. So, n2, this is n1. So, E2 minus E1 is equal to hc by lambda. Same thing we have written. Fine. So the Limer, Balmer, Pasteur and everything was just experimental finding. You can use that whenever they ask you to find out the wavelength. You can use that ready-made formula. 1 by lambda is Rydberg constant, everything else. Fine. Suppose they ask you to find the energy. You can use this. Okay. And suppose you are confused what to do, then use this. Okay, this is safe as well. Because you are going by logic here, right?